Okay, hi. So I'll talk about the OT and certain subgroups of OT. And the idea is, the title is from local to global structure. So the idea is to try and understand, okay, we have a subgroup of OT. So T will be a deregular tree throughout the talk. And we have a subgroup of OT. Okay, so we want to understand some properties of H. And the way to understand them is to somehow understand how it acts locally around each vertex, around finite subsets. And this is what I call a local action, and I'll spend the first part of the talk to define precisely what a local action is. And then the second part of the talk, I'll derive some properties of a group which is constructed by how it acts locally. So these groups are called the Burger-Moses universal groups. So I'll define them and we'll see some properties of them. Okay, let's start. So we already saw in Gil's talk how to construct an automorphism, but I want to talk about how to construct it locally. So in this point of view, I'm thinking of a G, an automorphism of the deregular tree. I'm thinking of it just as a map from vertices to vertices. Okay, which is bijective, and it preserves neighbors. Okay, so from this point of view, how do I construct an automorphism? Okay, I need to construct a bijection, so I just choose some V naught, and let's say it goes to U naught. Okay, so I have here V naught, and I'll keep drawing the free regular tree throughout the top, and I have, okay. And I'm sending this vertex to some U naught. Okay? Okay, now what do I need to define on all of these vertices? So I can continue like naturally to define on these vertices. Okay, and these vertices, where do they go? They go to neighbors of U naught. Okay, so, okay, I won't do it, but then I can go on larger and larger spheres, and this will totally describe the automorphism. Okay? Now suppose I have some G prime which acts on V naught the same as U naught. So I think we mentioned it in Gil's talk, that these two differ only by some action of the stabilizer of U naught. Okay, so let's see. It's clear. Okay, so we just so we can see that G inverse G prime is simply in the stabilizer of T of U naught. Okay. This is clear? Now, okay, when I say stabilizer, always I mean like the point-wise stabilizer. Okay? Okay. So, I lost a page, so let me just look for it. Okay, hope I didn't forget anything. So this I can do also for in general. So the I don't remember if I need anything else, but so that's it. So I can in general I can define for each H of H of V is just a stabilizer of V, and H HN of V is the stabilizer of the end ball around.
Shall I suggest notation? The stabilizer of the end ball usually is the stabilizer of the set.
Okay, so
I'll write otherwise fix. Okay, yeah. So is it the fixator? It's fixed at every point.
So I'll write fix.
I mean, for one point, it doesn't matter.
Yeah, okay. So I'll write fix. And, okay, and let's just make a few remarks. Of course, HN V is a subgroup of H in minus 1 V, etc. And we can go on and on to H1 V and H0 V, which I just denote H, H of V. Okay? And moreover, these subgroups are all normal in H of V. So they're normal, each of these are normal, but they're also normal in a big subgroup. And let's, it's not difficult to see, but I want somehow to get used to, that we all get used to this thinking. So so let's see that some H N of V is indeed normal in H V. Okay, so we take some N here and some G here, and we want to show that G inverse N G lies within H N. Okay, so
maybe N is a bad notation.
Maybe N is a bad. Okay, so take M. M is the worst notation. Okay, so we take H. H here and H. Okay, so we have V naught. And now G is acting on it. If G is in HV, so is G inverse. So G inverse just leaves V naught in its place. Okay? Since it leaves V naught in its place, since an automorphism preserves distances, it also preserves set-wise the end ball. Okay, so if I have here the end ball, it goes by G inverse to itself. Okay, now I have the action of H, which stabilizes, fixes point-wise this all this set, and then G inverse, then G acts and takes everything back to its place. Okay, you see it? Yes. Okay. So this is this. And now I want to somehow I said for the one sphere, I have some vertex going to you not, and then its neighbors are going somehow to these neighbors. Okay. If let's say this u not, let's make it simpler. If U naught is just V naught, okay, so I have this goes here, this induces some permutation on the neighbors. Okay? So what I have by the first remark so what we have is that each we can define let's do it just for now. H0 V simply to be the quotient group, which is this group is what's done to the stabilizer of V0 modulo the stabilizer of the one sphere. So I just said here that two automorphisms differ maybe by something that stabilizes. Okay, I didn't say it properly. If I have an G that fixes V naught, it induces a permutation on the neighbors. And if I have two such things, which also induce the same permutation here. So they differ, so they're in the same coset as the stabilizer of the one sphere, the fixator of the one sphere. OK? Okay, so what I want to say is that this is simply can be viewed somehow as a subgroup of the symmetric group on the neighbors. Okay, this also is bigger, and this is isomorphic somehow to the symmetric group on the elements when these the number of neighbors. Okay. Now we have this group which we know a lot about, and we want to somehow use it to analyze the automorphism group of the tree, to analyze the stabilizer, or to analyze each automorphism of the tree. But for now, we only have we did it. Okay, this how is this isomorphism done? This is like a technical issue that I'm going to spend like some time explaining. It's not so complicated, but it needs to be done. So how is this isomorphism done? Simply by labeling these edges. Okay. But so this only gives me a permutation of like something that stabilizes V0. But if I have, but actually I can do it for all vertices. Okay, each vertex I want to associate it with some kind of permutation it does around its each automorphism. I want to associate with some kind of permutation it does on the vertex. So I somehow need to canonically make this isomorphism. I want to make this isomorphism canonical for every V. Canonical for all V. So this is simply done by just labeling all the color, all the three together. Just okay. Once I have like this labeling, and then I continue any way I want. I know I can color the tree. It's a tree. It's very easy. So let me like define it. Just so we have. So we have it. Definition: a coloring is a map I from the edges to the set of the elements such that I restricted to the set of neighbors around V is a bijection for all V. Okay, so for every vertex I have this coloring. For every tree I have a coloring. Okay, now we can actually define what I want to define, which is a local action. So local action. So let G in OT be some automorphism, and I, let I be a coloring of T, and G in OT. We define the local action. Of G at a vertex V to be the following permutation, which is it's denoted like this, and it's simply I write it and then I'll say it. So the local permutation is just the local action is just I'll say it in words and then you can understand the definition. Say I have something that fixes V0. I have these colorings. I have these colorings. V0 permutes it somehow. Say it sends 1 to 2 and 2 to 1 and keeps 3 in place. So the local action is just 1 goes to 2, 2 goes to 1, and 3 stays in place. So this is the local action for this coloring of this G at V0. Okay. There's really nothing. sigma ij depends on I. Okay, it's fairly, because it's a tree, it's fairly trivial to think that the coloring doesn't matter. We can obviously color it in any way we want. But once I fix the coloring, these objects are indeed depend on it. Okay, if I color it, it seems trivial, but let me just say what I wanted to notice. That the automorphism of a tree doesn't see the coloring. Okay? The automorphism of the tree simply knows that it sends this edge to this edge. Okay? And if I put some kind of, it's the same for the automorphism if I put this coloring or if I put another coloring, say 2, 1. Okay, so it's a trivial remark, but it's useful later to remember that there is a difference between the automorphism of a tree and the permutations that we induce from it. Okay, and the second remark is, for now, all we have is a bunch of symmetries, local symmetries, and we want to give this thing a structure, some kind of structure. We want to give it a structure. Some kind of structure. So the following demo just shows us how to do that. For G and H in O T and V and V, we have that the local permutation of the product of G and H at V is, you want to think about it? Oh. I want to write it as like some kind of function of the local action of G and H. So,
if you've been here enough, you should guess.
Yeah, you can guess what it is. You want to think about it for 30 seconds?
Okay.
Okay, so think about it. And a good way to think about it is to draw it. Okay, so let's draw it. Didn't know if I waited 30 seconds or not. I'll draw it slowly. So we have here G, here G. And how did I write it? G. So we have H, moving this here. And we have G, moving this here. And we already fixed the coloring I, so let's say it's 1, 2, 3. 3, 2, 1. And 1, 2, 3. OK, so I do it by example, but the example is the same everywhere.
Maybe before you do the example, you know, just to have people, get familiar with this, we may think of this local action as some sort of derivative at a point. And this link of a point, we should or could think of it as some sort of a singular tangent space to the point. So there is, in this context, there is a name to what it all is about to
change.
The chain of of the differentials. And if you prefer homological algebra, there is another name for this, which is called
homological
algebra. Okay. This is the one for cycle relation.
So this is okay. And let's say. Let's say this goes, GH takes this here, and G takes this here, and it preserves the geometric painting. So we have the local action of H at V is simply 1 goes to 3, 2 goes to 2, and 3 goes to 1. And then here we have 3 goes to 3, 1 goes to 2, and 2 goes to 1. And if we compose them, I have 1 goes to 3, 3 goes to 3, so it's 1 goes to 3. 2 goes to 2 goes to 1, 2 goes to 1, and 3 goes to 2. And one can check that this is simply this permutation. Okay? So this is one, and the second we won't spend too much time on, but it's just that the inverse, the local action of the inverse of G is simply the local action of G at a inverse inverse. What this actually shows is, okay, keep this in mind, and
just if you already check it, 2 follows formally from 1.
So this gives us so this brings us to the definition of the universal groups. Okay. So one definition. T is the T regular tree. And I coloring. Let F be some subgroup of the symmetric group on the elements, and define the following group. All the automorphisms in OT such that the local action, for each automorphism, its local action at each vertex is in fact in F. So maybe it's not clear that it's a group, but this lemma immediately implies that it's a group. Why? what's the condition? The condition is simply that an automorphism is here if its local action at each vertex is in F. Okay, so the product of two such elements, you see here, the product of two such elements at some v is simply the product of the local action at of one's local action at some vertex and of the other local action at some other vertex. So if this is in F and this is in F by the assumption on G and H, then this product is also. And this is implied. And so this is in fact a group. So before I make some claims about it, I want to show you 2 examples. Okay, the 2 most simple examples you can think of. I'll do the first one, maybe. No. Okay, maybe I'll do the first one. I'll just say the first one, then we take a break, and then we'll do the second. But the first one is very simple. So what's the simplest example? So what I have is, this is fixed, this is fixed, and this is fixed only, so the only thing I can choose is this set. Okay? So what's the simplest example?
There are 2 simplest examples.
Take F to be all simplest.
Take F to be all simplest, right. This is really simple. This was a Freudian. So what is it? And don't okay, what is it? So okay, think about it, folks. Okay, so it's OT. Okay, it's OT, and that before I say it, this is actually like when I wanted to define local action and to try to derive think about the global group, I wanted to have to actually have some tool to allow me to check locally something and then derive something about the whole group. And this is exactly what I need to do here. All I need, this is a local condition. All I have to check in order to see if some G is in the universal group is just to take a vertex and see how it acts there. So I need to do it for all vertices, which is maybe sometimes not easy, but anyway, if this is the whole group, there is no condition here. It's a trivial condition. So this is in fact OT. And we'll do the second. This is same. And we'll do the second group, second obvious group to take, which is not so obvious here. We'll do it after the break, so you can think about it during the break if you want. This is the trivial group. How do you denote it? One?
Okay.
Oh,
ID.
Okay. So this is an exercise for the bike.
This is an exercise for the bike.
Everyone should solve it.
And you can, actually. It's not a...
So this is break time?
Yes, break time.